You're listening to Tune Dig, a conversation between two lifelong friends about the power of music, one album at a time. I'm Cliff Seal.
And I'm Kyle Stapleton. Each episode, we talk about a single album in depth, unpacking it through conversation to understand what makes it worth appreciating and learning a little bit about life along the way.
If you're listening for the first time because we're covering an artist or a record you love, we promise you'll learn something new or gain a new perspective by the end of the episode.
And if you've stuck with us for multiple episodes, you know by now that you're bound to expand your horizons as we share clear entry points for artists you may never have tried to get into before.
Today we're talking about Sour by Olivia Rodrigo.
So I want to issue a couple of guardrails.
Kyle, what's happening here?
Right off the top. I'm old. That's what's happening. There are two phenomena that are sort of the edges of where I want to go with this conversation. I want to avoid two abysses, if at all possible. The first is, for those of you who have seen 21 Jump Street, the parking lot scene, where I'm just one-strapping my way through this conversation, and then I inadvertently punch somebody for no reason and just show what an out-of-touch old idiot I am immediately. So stop me. Stop this episode if it veers too far into college guy at the high school party still wearing his Leatherman jacket type vibe. Really want to strenuously avoid that. The second is, while preparing for this episode, I saw a tweet, and I'm just going to read it. At Static Blue Bat says, I wish I could remember who it was that said this, but I remember seeing someone say that Patrick Bateman's pop music monologues are less effective in 2022 because that's how everyone talks about pop music now. So, you know, short of the maybe probably very legitimate Led Zex murder Jared Leto part of that whole deal, I'd like to avoid sounding like Anthony Fantano on this whole thing.
The internet's busiest music nerd.
Somebody actually literally replied with a screenshot of Fantano's face, and the tweet is meant to be read in his voice. I think they're undisputed masterpieces. Hip to be square. A song so catchy, most people probably don't listen to the lyrics. Like, you can hear Anthony Fantano Bateman. So anyway, I want to create the negative space right now of the things that I don't want to do. Having said that, it is a bit of a point of pride we've been texting about. We chose to do the cover of this album like kind of a long while before any of this stuff started happening around it. Not that any of these things needed to happen to legitimize what is interesting and good and unique about this record. But in the time since we selected and have been preparing to talk about this album, it had a full documentary released about it that is great, and we will talk about parts of it and what makes it great. And it won 3 Grammys, which again, does not need the institutional legitimization from the old guard, but maybe it could be the one thing that tips one person in the direction of listening to it if it's not us, right?
Not all rectangles are squares, but some Grammys can point you in the right direction.
That's right. If it's the one that Mariska Hargitay did a shot out of, that was David Diggs, which is currently one of my favorite TikToks making the rounds again.
But not if it's skipping Power Trip in 2021, which is the unforgivable sin.
If it has a guitar in it, we should give the Grammy to the Foo Fighters for sure. R.I.P. Taylor. So let's talk about Olivia Rodrigo, who blew up with a song called Driver's License and was literally born in the year 2003 when we got our driver's licenses. She's born after 9/11, which is a little bit of a trip. I always said that's the point at which I would retire once I had colleagues that were that age. And we have this curious case of, like, so immediately you watch a documentary, you start poking in on Olivia and her career and like her ascendancy. It's not long before you run into a quote like, she grew up listening to her parents' favorite alternative rock music, such as the bands No Doubt, Pearl Jam, The White Stripes, and Green Day. And you just have to take a deep breath and you're like, this music was not made for me. But that's okay.
If you find yourself offended by that sentence grouping of artists, you may not like.
I guess it is a little weird.
I was like, White Stripes, what?
Yeah. Also, Pearl Jam, a full decade
right,
before it.
Right.
Yeah. So that's one interesting thing to know about her, I think. The other thing that was like, oh, this makes a lot of sense, is she has the same birthday as my wife and Rihanna and Kurt Cobain, who are all intense Pisces people. So for those of you who are astrologically inclined and you know one or more Pisces, everything about this record will make a lot of sense while you're listening to it, because it is big and bright feelings. And if you're in that part of your life where biologically your big and bright feelings have been tamped down by the stampede of the passing of time and the brutality of labor under capitalism, then the flavor may be a little too sharp for you. The frequency cuts through super clear. One of the things I thought was really interesting that I want you to jump in with is just like, let's talk about pop music. I think it's easy to jump into sort of the phenomenology of this record, and I hope that we'll spend time talking about the songs, but let's zoom out for a second. Now that I've done my old man cane shaking a little bit, like, you provided very valuable perspective for me in the lead up to this episode, just for the benefit of our listeners.
Well, you spent a moment trying to verbalize your old man thing, but my old man thing follows me in the front of my brain in all of my experiences. So I was already out in front of any record like this before I ever knew that I could hear and enjoy this record. I thought that it was a record that I would never listen to. A teenager who grew up in the Disney Channel original movie verse who was not in Brink. That's got nothing to do with me, man. If it's not Johnny's Tsunami, we're in the wrong Disney Channel decade. All right.
Maybe my date with the president's daughter. Maybe. That's as far as I'll go.
Or like Wish Upon a Star, you know? That sort of thing. But like, especially without, I mean, I'm a child-free individual. I got no exposure, for the most part, to someone who would have fit into my mold of who digs this record. And then this record became a meta way for me and you to start talking about how to not miss great pop. Mm-hmm. Because the only way that this came into my stratosphere at all was that someone started to play it before I knew what was happening. And I heard the first guitar line come in on Brutal. And I thought straight up, someone has either found a way to get Queens of the Stone Age to do a pop record, or someone is aping them so directly that I really need, like, I need to understand, is a Greta Van Fleet thing happening now for Caius in pop? Like, I gotta chase this whole rabbit down. Like, what song is this, right? And then that, I think you and I have joked about a lot, that this whole record, as an active listening experience, can be a whole and then, because everything that they choose to do production-wise works.
Yep.
It is a masterful pop record in a different way than pop traditionally has great pop records.
Yep.
Like, this is twisty and turny without ever leaving the overall genre that Olivia Rodrigo needs to stay inside of. And yet, it's this giant post-internet blob of things that we can recognize because it's all from times where we paid a lot of attention to music. Like, now, all of a sudden, as I made my way through this record the first time, and then now, you know, having listened to it a lot more than I ever expected.
Enough times, like, that while I was playing it as we were setting the equipment up, you were singing the words to it.
You betrayed me! Yeah.
No kidding, other than maybe Me Without You, I can't think of a single other episode where you just like whistle while you worked to it. And this would have been the farthest thing that I would have guessed. Like, oh, Cliff is all in on this record, boy. Cliff is listening to this record outside of the context of this podcast.
Yep.
He's broken out of the gravity of the Toon Dig cinematic universe, and he just likes it as a person.
It's true. This and Dolly put some real tunes inside of my head. So did Otis Redding, but that kind of leads to a different vibe when you go around just singing. Yeah. But this became a real exploration in, like, actually, I don't think we've talked about this before, but to me, this is a better form of when we used to talk about how we ought to cover a Justin Timberlake record.
Yep.
Because the idea...
So glad we never did that,
by the way. Oh, yeah. It's nice to be right about things. But the reason we used to talk about that it would be helpful to bring out a Justin Timberlake record is because you've got a matchup of a very, very good vocalist, someone who really knows what they're doing, and true great production, deep, detailed, layered word painting type stuff that still fits within the boundaries of a particular vibe and genre. And this record does an even better job of both of those things than we would have ended up covering anyway. And now we don't have to talk about Cry Me a River, which, you know, saves me a lot of time.
How long do you have to talk about toxic masculinity? You know, the Queens of the Stone Age thing was my in, was you texted me about it and said, hey, I found a pop song that's like an Era Vulgaris song. And then it was the down strum of the guitars. Yep. It was the really dry drums. And the vocals on that record are a lot like I'm Designer. It's very like snitty.
Yeah.
Very punk. The first thing that I thought of actually when I listened to the song and the lyrics were No Fun by the Stooges.
Yeah.
Where it's just like,
yeah, there's a lot of Iggy Pop
energy. Dead simple, very Iggy Pop. The rest of the record is not like that, and I'm glad, but that was a great Trojan horse for me. And now, having seen the documentary and knowing that that song came along late in the process, and she's like, we need something up tempo. We need to like get the lead out a little bit. And it was a quick, like he wrote the strum riff on an acoustic guitar sitting in the room, and they just kind of rip. It's like more or less one or two vocal takes where she just kind of ripped it out. And then also in the documentary, she performs those songs in different settings. And that one is inside the hull of an airplane in the Mojave Desert with an all-girl band. And it reminded me of the Bourdain episode where he goes and he hangs out with Josh Homme and they're like tapping into the mysticism of the desert.
I had to dig deep. I had to go places, both inside my head and outside. And in the end, after searching and searching, as so many who come out here to this strange and savage landscape do, I found it. The perfect note, a pure, ballistically delivered note. A blow against the empire, a ringing, single, beautiful strike, a hammer of the gods that will live in rock forever.
She's tuned in to a frequency way beyond what I expected for this record, so I'm all in for whatever the rest of this is. So I hope that whether it's this song or another song on the record, it's a very shuffleable record.
Yep.
I think the important thing to know about it is if you're on a mood for a song and it's too low or too high, you're going to get to another place immediately. It's the Frank Ocean effect that we talked about with Channel Orange. It's like you're going to hit the remote and go to a different thing. And it's sometimes it's best if it's not what you expected.
Yeah.
The next time. And that's one of many things that I think is cool happening in post-internet popular music, where it's just like none of that matters. Like what defines a great record is a lot different than the narrative arc or sonic arc or whatever, all the shit that we needed 20 whatever years ago.
Yeah. And it was surprising to be able to pick out then, speaking of it being post-internet, it's such a, like, how have we ended up here musically over all these years of technology moment? Because you can go in and it's almost like you can sift it into like, well, that's Taylor Swift, that's Hayley Williams, that's Regina Spektor, that's Alanis Morissette. And you can really start to pick out what it means to have grown up in an era where exposure to music was just, well, what would you like to listen to today?
Right.
We like to try to draw that out a lot in these episodes anyway, about how culture or moments have changed the way that music evolved and all that. But I mean, this is a real accumulation of an entire ass person, a real human being, going all the way through the process of being born after not wondering if Y2K would be a thing. Like, entirely after that, all the way past, like, not having to struggle to go discover music on your own and download it, not even having that moment of exploration where it's like, well, you can find anything you want, but you have to remember what it is that you're looking for because no meta catalog of everything exists. This is just what happens when people are born for their entire lives having access to anything that they want to use as influence. And then therefore, you know, I think something that's been brought up a couple of times was the influence of Olivia Rodrigo's parents on her and their musical influence. And like, just think about that kind of swirling ball of being, now you're, yeah, I mean, Kyle, you're having this experience, or you will soon. Like, you're an adult now with access to all of the history of music after having been a person who didn't have access to the entire history of music. And you're about to have to figure out how to talk to your kid about, like, gestures broadly. And that's a lot for somebody who cares about music and who cares about the story of it and what it all
means.
Never
been more stoked about a responsibility in my whole life. The thing about that access piece, I use an X-Man analogy. It's like all of that access, all of those reference points are like Cyclops glasses, because Olivia Rodrigo, the person, part of this is she's a young person. And at that age, like your feelings go supersonic. Like, I'm not minimizing or trivializing that at all. Like, I see,
yeah, no, that's really how it feels.
I see so much of when I was 16, 17, 18, 19 in this, and I haven't really thought about it in a pointed way in a really long time. This just reminded me of the person I was when I had a Zanga blog and was just like, oh God. And she just does so much better a job wielding that. And I think part of it is because she has that vehicle of like, she's Cyclops without glasses, like every teenager, just like lasering everything with very intense feelings. But these point the lasers in a direction and they give her a superpower. You made the Fiona Apple comparison in the lead up to this, just the poignancy with which she articulates her feelings. And it really comes out in the documentary. Like, you get really struck by a couple of things. One is, how the hell do you have this much of a grasp on what you're feeling and thinking when your feelings are moving at 120 miles an hour at all times? And two, the way she talks about time and that whole thing, like, this, I wrote this song at a time in my life when I was feeling X, and like, the whole cycle of writing the record is 12 or 18 months or whatever. And you're just like, homie, what the shit? Absolutely. Like, that just happened. And I don't think that's an Olivia thing. I don't think that's a teenager thing. My assessment is that more than anything, that's just how time is sped up. We talked in the Erykah Badu episode about how she talked about her kids and how they're vibrating at a faster frequency now. I thought about that a lot. Like, a lot of the season seems like it's turning out to be about feelings and expressing feelings.
My
and,
dream come true. And it, right.
you've been doing therapy. That's what this is, like the final boss exercise.
Yeah, I know. I'm like, getting plenty of it there. This. Yeah.
No, you got to do it in public now. It's the seventh step or whatever. You're making amends or in some barbaric way.
It's like having to go into therapy and then coming out of it like it's a courtroom and people are interviewing you. Just like, what'd you learn in there? What do you have to say?
You fall asleep after the exhaustion of therapy and then you have the dream where you didn't study for the test, but it's you talking publicly about your feelings.
Right. Taking a deep breath and going, well, what I understand about myself now.
You walk out of therapy in the dream and the next room over is the set of Tonight Show with Jimmy Fallon and you got to get on the couch and it's like, well.
I did just get a vision of like Sway getting me in the back room. Just like, hey man, what happened to know what's up?
Will you freestyle about your feelings? That's far enough down that rabbit hole, I hope. But she says in the documentary, my style of songwriting gets a little overwhelming. I was going a million miles an hour writing stuff down while I was watching that doc, which, by the way, almost all female crew on this documentary, directed by Stacey Lee, DP'd by Zoe Simone Yee, edited by Nia Amani. I wrote, the shot of the Mexican restaurant in the documentary is some A24 shit. Like, it's beautiful. It's filmic. The score is amazing. And you're like, okay, well, she was a Disney Channel person. Like, none of this should be this artful and beautiful and mature.
Right. The most recent thing that she's been doing is High School Musical, the series.
But okay. The thing that I'm used to and maybe the acceleration of culture has moved people beyond this, it's like the obvious virtue signaling into I'm a serious artist or I'm an adult artist now or whatever. She skipped past all of that.
Totally. Yep.
Into I'm just going to do exactly whatever I want. And that's what real maturity is. Like, I don't have to tell you that I'm mature. I'm just going to do it.
You mean she did what Miley Cyrus said that she was doing at the time? Yeah.
And she didn't even have to wear a Bulls jersey and do weird cultural appropriation.
We let's just give her time, Kyle. Okay. Let's, everyone has time to make their own mistakes in their 20s.
Olivia Rodrigo and Mike Will made it. I see, that would be tight. There's also a thread that she pulls at, thinking about the spectrum of feelings. She pulls at some really age-old things that I think are interesting. Like she's talking to that Jacob Collier guy, the perfect pitch, mega talent, whatever. They're just like hanging out on the hood of her Jeep in the desert, like very not planned interview situation. And they're talking about driver's license, which like probably worth stopping down for a second. If culture didn't whistle in your ear at the frequency of driver's license and you just missed that it happened, it was massive as shit. All of a sudden, out of nowhere. So in the documentary, they are talking about where the inspiration comes from. And she's like, storytelling and inspiration doesn't have to come from a place of devastation. And she expressed a worry, like, I'm not going to be devastated for all of my life. So what do I do then? You know, she's 17, 18, tapped into the Teddy Perkins, great things come from great pain argument already, you know, like already thinking about the blues and what do I do when the blues go away? And there's a really cool moment where it shows her recording driver's license, like a demo of it on her phone, but playing it on the keyboard in a room. And there's very conveniently a framed album cover of that Smith self-titled record right over her shoulder. Just for the wink of what?
No, I just happen to wear this Bad Brains shirt every day. I didn't put it on for this interview.
Yeah, it's got a ketchup stain on it and it's well worn. So like you have the sensation of the Bo Burnham, the movie that he did, the eighth grade movie, where it's like, oh my God, the whole mediated existence. So you're thinking about acceleration there. And then it cuts to a montage of like, you know, this is how music happens. You write it in your bedroom and then you play it on these big stages. But like, it's a very intimate, specific song. And then it cuts to she's playing it on late night shows and award shows and festivals and massive stages. And she stops singing and thousands of girls are singing it back to her. And it's instant phenomenology, just because it comes from a really authentic and deep place. And it's just, I can't imagine that being my life. You write some shit, you play it for some friends on your Instagram Live, and all of a sudden you're at Austin City Limits. And that's another thing that she's just kind of handled.
Almost literally, I'm going to upload this sound to TikTok and just see what happens.
Yeah.
And then turns out it's the most happening thing to have ever happened upon that happenstance on TikTok ever. That's why this is all, to me, such an interesting little moment in time in music, because it's like driver's license was the thing that compelled the album to exist at all.
Oh, that's right.
Driver's license blows up on TikTok, which is like, I feel like this is a real moment where like anyone listening to this podcast gets extremely segmented into their experience, because either you immediately know what I mean by it blew up on TikTok, or you think you know what that means and you actually have no idea how like sounds spread on that social network, how it plays into people creating videos based on it and like all that stuff. And like, me and you are not TikTok experts, but enough to understand the mechanisms of it.
Yeah.
But like, it's just such a wild phenomenon that never, ever existed before this moment.
Right.
And it is the primary way that one song that was about getting a driver's license, which to me, that's where everything keeps getting more interesting every time you turn it around. The thing that caught my attention about that was this generation like doesn't have the same connection to cars that we do at all.
Right.
Like me and you literally.
And it's not a ride at 16 thing. Right. They're doing it later.
Yeah. Ever.
So it taps into a timelessness thing.
Yeah. Yeah,
it's weird.
Which is, if there's one big takeaway from the songwriting, I would say, it's that phenomenon plays out across this record. And I don't know if it's, I'm going to assume it's got something to do with the producer and co-writer of Sour was Daniel Nigro from As Tall as Lions, and who's done work with like Carly Rae Jepsen and stuff. To me, the thing that's really different about this record that makes it not cringe, which dates me anyway, just by saying cringe, I guess. But like the thing that makes it not unbearable from a lyrical perspective, which is exactly where most things are unbearable for me, Okay.
As covered in an episode or two earlier this season.
Yeah.
You just want to continue documenting the... Every band would be instrumental if it were up to Cliff.
Yeah, phenomenon. I'm just slowly revealing that vocals are the worst thing ever. But Driver's License encapsulates what a lot of those other songs do, which is somehow it's a song about that moment and the irrationality of all of your feelings and how stupid everything feels and how final everything feels. And yet also seems to speak about it in a way that is able to express just enough of the perspective that you get 5, 10, and 15 years down the road.
Yeah.
Where you are able to at once notice that something is wrong and it's been broken and I hurt and all of that stuff. But then she would keep coming back to things like, I know we weren't perfect. Like just that little bit of sensation that we, I think, are all able to have once we're 25, 30, and longer, where we look back on the moments where we were young and we remember feeling the way that we felt and we can like feel a sense of empathy for that moment where it's like, I felt like everything was broken forever. And I knew in that moment as well that my feeling about that wasn't really in line with reality. It wouldn't always feel this way, but I didn't know how to feel like things wouldn't always feel this way. Because things have always felt.
Couldn't break out of the loop.
Yeah. You never had enough lived experience to get distance from anything. So you didn't even know how to figure out what it might feel like to get perspective on that moment.
She does a great job of throwing the emotional ball downfield to like not where she is in that moment, but to where she's going to be. The big chorus.
That's a great way of putting it. Yeah.
The big bridge. But I still fucking love you, babe. Oh, that when it gets to that, there's so many like chest pat moments in this. That's another way that I feel like it's a big punk record.
Yeah.
Because there's so much stuff that's just like, I'm going to cry. I'm going to cry in this pit. I'm holding a tall boy beer. Don't make me cry in this pit, Olivia. Yeah. Just, I don't. Ugh.
Yeah.
There are so many moments on the record. I've had to turn this record off a lot.
Yeah.
Because it's just like, ooh, right in the bright spot.
That's definitely one literal tweak of the whole thing is like, yeah, it's going to get talked about as a teenage angst breakup record, but you shouldn't position it that way, like emotionally almost.
Yeah.
It's kind of more of a get you stoked and pump you up record.
Yeah.
Even though it has all these little acoustic moments and like interludes and sad songwriting and all like the overall feeling of it, especially listened to as like a body of work instead of just the singles necessarily. Yeah. You kind of get amped instead. And it's not the feeling that you would necessarily expect. But to me, that's where like the interplay of being surprised by the perspective in the songwriting and then at the same time being surprised by the detail in the production, that you just ping pong back and forth between those two things for this whole record.
And you just go, wow.
Yeah.
Wow. Just Owen Wilson. Just wow.
Yeah. That's what made me want to start listening to it at all. And then what made it worth talking about. You can position it as a way to get you to open yourself back up to music you don't usually pay attention to. The reason we don't usually pay attention to pop is because it's usually not very rewarding at all to listen to pop music because it's simplistic. You understand where it's going. Nothing is a surprise. Whereas here, like, I mean, just hitting a couple of moments, the very beginning of this song, the like car beep that they turn into part of the beat.
Another very Queens of the Stone Age moment. I got very excited. Like the beginning of Songs for the Deaf. Just like, yes.
Or the beginning of that Linkin Park record before we knew that they were crazy. Where they were like hitting the cinder block with a hammer.
I forgot about that.
Yeah. So the car beep intro turns into something production-wise. And then, you know, you mentioned the part where, you know, they swell up into the I still fucking love you. But like, they stop at like 2 minutes and 30 seconds into a huge single and the song just stops and switches into another style entirely.
Yeah, yeah.
Like that whole chorus bit, there was no smooth transition to it before there. There was just at some point, some group of people in the studio went, that's exactly what needs to happen right there.
Yeah.
And just turned the entire song. And to me, like the willingness to stop and shift in a totally different direction is a big strength of this record and what made me feel like Driver's License is connected stylistically to Brutal. Because the same way that at the end of Brutal, they all of a sudden start slowing it down for no reason. It was like
your favorite move in hardcore.
The reason it's my favorite move in hardcore is because it's the thing to do when you realize that we've been playing this riff for too long this way.
Yeah.
Like, well, here, how can we shift it immediately and make it weird? I'm like, okay. That moment in Driver's License, like switching to a chant with reverb after basically a sad ass little thing has been going on for a couple of minutes, like sort of is the meta thing that makes this a rewarding listen overall as a record. Mm-hmm. And then even after, like it breaks back into like when she sings like, I know we weren't perfect, and climbs the scale with just the piano, like it's really chromatic and winds back up and like, this, it's just a wild selection of production to begin with on any song, much less one that was created before there would be an album to wrap around this single to begin with.
Which is such a fun thing to point out on the podcast about albums. It's just like, this has been a real celebration of that format of like a body of work, an hour or so long of expression where you go in a bunch of different dynamic directions. Interesting sort of generationally that that's not the default mode in a lot of ways. Like put out the single, get on a playlist, whatever. You can also liken it to the same thing happened with Lil Nas X and Old Town Road. So she's not a lone example in that. Like there are multiple cultural touch points of like, this is a model, but also that she was determined. She's like, I know this belongs in the context of a number of other emotional landscapes, and I want to take people multiple places, which is a little anachronistic, right? So there's the, she does such a great job balancing the like, right now, this can be me and only me, with the larger, more timeless touch points about how to, you know, air quotes, do music. The second single after that was Deja Vu. She expressed anxiety about putting out a song after Driver's License that was such a phenomenon. And the interesting thing about Deja Vu is it is about the feeling that no feeling you have is special, which is such an interesting and crushing thing about growing up. She said that she wanted to write a song that was really vivid and specific. This was another one of those, like, Jesus, how old are you really moments. She said, specificity and authenticity are my two favorite things a song can have. I learned that from country music. And of all the other touch points that we've talked about, like, I thought about the Dolly episode a lot when I was listening to this record and watching that documentary. There is another song on the record called Enough For You that reminds me a lot stylistically of Early Morning Breeze.
Yeah. Oh, yes. Holy shit.
So there's a lot of Dolly on there. And I think a lot of the things that are charming and appealing about Dolly Parton are sort of appealing about Olivia Rodrigo, too. Like the bringing an ASL interpreter to accompany all of her interviews at the Grammys. Like, I don't want to make too big a deal about that, but it's cool because other people don't do it. That attempt to be inclusive without being really performative about it is a very Dolly Parton move.
Yep.
So like, I don't want to hang that on Olivia's coat rack. Like, I hope she's the next Dolly Parton. But there are a lot of cool things that I have come to that have made me appreciate Olivia Rodrigo more that are like the kind of things that people cite about Dolly Parton that they appreciate.
Well, what we can and should say is Olivia Rodrigo seems like she is in the lineage of the progeny of Dolly. And so are we, though. Like, Dolly has spread out into more people need to be like this.
Yeah, that's true.
Figure out how to not be a piece of shit and not tell everybody that you're not being a piece of shit at the same time.
Oh, no, but what will happen? How will anyone know otherwise?
Well, that's the problem. Yeah, how will I get Instagram followers without telling people I'm not a piece of shit?
How will I get Good Place points if people don't upvote me for Good Place points?
No one likes Dolly's answer, which is then don't go in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. You know?
But I need it.
Then don't put my bust in the Tennessee Capitol, you know? Like, no one likes that answer because it's like, well, but I still want the thing and I want to be neurotic about it.
Yeah. Darling, are you willing to accept the possibility of ego death in your life? Well, then, don't know what to tell you.
I think you brought up Enough for You in there, which had some of that feel. That was another really positive pop connection for me because there's, you know, we talked about there's plenty of Taylor Swift, Regina Spektor type departures. There's a lot of Hayley Williams and just Paramore in general. Like Paramore across the ages, there's a lot of Paramore in here. But Enough for You specifically brought out to me the Inside Once Out era of John Mayer, where he was doing songs like My Stupid Mouth and Neon, where there is this, if you'll go with me here, and this is part of this like the way that the songwriting happens on this record, like why it's so interesting. So on Inside Once Out, which was John Mayer's stuff before basically, you know, No Such Thing blew up and Your Body is a Wonderland. So before he ever played Your Body is a Wonderland or tried to make fun of it, you baddie, before he ever did that, like there's this record of extremely introspective acoustic songs that basically he used to play at Eddie's Attic just up the street in Decatur.
Sorry to the person who has never been to Atlanta, Georgia. Eddie's Attic is your local, small, intimate singer-songwriter venue on the square in Decatur, a town adjacent to Atlanta, with like a little sort of boheme vibe.
Yeah, like you're not supposed to talk, that kind of shit.
Yeah.
But the perfect place
it's,
where...
It's our Bluebird Cafe, maybe.
Yeah.
A little bit. Yeah.
Yeah, the place where the really introspective type of songwriters go to not feel so awkwardly introspective.
Yeah.
And it works.
Your song. Audience is normally other people who are trying to also do the same thing.
Yeah.
It's the improv venue filled with only other improvers, yeah. Typically.
Like lots of that kind of Ben Howard type. I'm really wordy and using acoustics as more of like a backdrop to
this
the story.
This is capital S serious.
Yeah.
I'm a real musician.
Sometimes they are. And sometimes it sounds good. John Mayer was one of those who was actually a good enough like musician to be able to do.
We just had to endure a 20-year Ouroboros of John Mayer ego before he ego died and joined the Grateful Dead and is now one of the weirdly zenest people alive. Sort of a Jim Carrey thing in music.
Like emotional Benjamin Button. Yeah, great. He's getting bigger and sillier. But like on Inside Once Out, My Stupid Mouth and Neon especially are these approaches to songwriting that seem like they're telling you a story from a first-person perspective, but have a moment where they begin to negotiate with the person telling the story as if you've been reading a book thinking you're hearing it in first person, and then turns out you're hearing it in third person representing what the first person was thinking, but now you're the third person and you don't know who you are.
Hits blunt.
Yeah, and so like with John Mayer, like an example of that would be like on My Stupid Mouth, he says, you know, I'm never speaking up again, and then says like, starting now. And then like the whole song fades and then he says one more thing, and then he comes back in and starts the next verse. And it's this kind of, I am aware of the moment that I'm speaking about right now, and I feel like I can commune with the person I was when I was experiencing this story. And so the song is actually about current day me and that me kind of having a dialogue about whatever was happening here and however we can like explain it to ourselves and feel it out. So on Enough for You, like a couple of minutes in, I think she says like, someday I'll be everything to somebody else and they'll think I'm so exciting. And like, those are the moments where you can't feel that when it's happening. If you feel anything close to that when you're feeling brokenhearted, that's pure resentment.
Right.
That's like, oh, you're gonna regret losing me, buddy.
These boots were made for walking.
Yeah. Whereas like the way it actually gets approached in these songs, she runs right up to the line of the kind of like, you know what, fuck you, dude. Like right up to it, and then backs off only in the way that you can once you're a full-fledged adult.
Right.
Once you've realized that you cannot spend your emotional energy on everything all of the time, but it's like a move that you don't know as an 18-year-old.
Right.
And so to me, that theme keeps playing out a lot on this record in a way that keeps it from being silly, that keeps it from feeling like I don't want to relive this part of my life so much. I'm not really interested in what this is talking about here.
Yeah, you almost look back with a nostalgia on some of those types of feelings, which is insane, because when you're in the middle of them, it feels like your house just got flattened by a tropical storm,
right?
You know? So that, I think, is a huge credit to her ability as a songwriter. And you're right that the nuance of getting right up to the line of full 100% uncut feelings and backing it off just a little with some perspective, like, I'm going to get it as raw as I can, but back it out just a little. And you can see some of that in some of the songwriting decisions that they make in the moment on the documentary. But like, enough for you, she said of that song. It's about having the care and kindness to have the courage to be honest with people you love. Like, did you say any shit like that? Did you have a thought like that your head when you were...
No.
Before? Yeah, not even a little. So for that reason, and for the reason that she was playing a disco ball Rhodes in the middle of the woods in Doc Martens while performing that song, just like, everything about this is super rad. I don't want to put too much weight on her. It's not my place to do anything like this. But thinking about all the things that like Fiona Apple and Alanis Morissette had to endure, mm-hmm. being visible and vulnerable and like bearing the weight of capital W women everywhere for just like trying to exist and do things that straight white dudes can just kind of do without consequence. In it, you know, there's 1,000 David Lee Roth that we don't question at all, but let one Alanis Morissette talk about Dave Coulier and the whole thing shuts down. I felt so glad as the dad of a daughter that I want to just let exist in all her multitudes and flaws in the world and not be constantly interrogated and lumped into a group, to just like have all the privileges that we had growing up. Basically, I felt really glad that girls and young people broadly around the world can see her and like feel seen by all of these multitudes. It made me feel like young people and youth culture, in spite of all the bullshit, that the crushing weight coming down on them from previous generations, all that they have been able to do and become, you feel it in such sharp relief in a moment, like watching her perform that song and talk about a song like that.
So kind of relative to what you were saying about being able to kind of experience all of those feelings and have these songs that are about hopefully just being able to express something and not have it interrogated all the time. Interestingly enough, we are talking about the seeming maturity that comes from however these songs were written, but, you know, giving a sense of perspective that doesn't usually exist for someone around the age of 18. But I also think it was helpful to contrast this again, as a record that seemed ostensibly to be a breakup record, and people really love talking about how much of a breakup record it is, but like, I am going to quite literally date myself in this moment, but if I were to pick a breakup record that would have occurred at a time when we were 18, that would have been Dashboard Confessional. Okay. And so, but thinking about,
I don't claim that. I rebuke that.
I'm not,
I hear you, but also respectfully,
I'm just saying, hell no. If you had to pick a breakup record in the like 2004-ish timeframe, someone's going to make an argument for Chris Carrabba.
If you were a terrible boyfriend, you probably would have loved this.
But that brings kind of what you were talking about into sharp relief, because those songs were like, this is the best day I can ever remember, right? They're extremely written from the perspective of the exact moment that they were experienced in. There's no desire to gain perspective. There's no real desire to even comment. Like, the whole kind of movement and eventual cartooning of emo was like, I refuse to be anywhere except this exact raw edge of an emotional moment, and refuse to,
for you.
And I refuse to interrogate whether this is a reasonable thing to feel or think at all.
Yeah.
You know, or like, you know, and Screaming Infidelities, where it's just like, your hair is everywhere. Like, they're all extremely present moment feelings and realizations about being hurt.
Yeah.
And so many places on this record, you know, we've mentioned them, on Driver's License and Brutal, but even Traitor is a pretty good, like, almost like a mature emo kind of thing, because she builds you all the way up sort of energetically with this sort of like, woe is me almost stuff. But then the way that she performs after she builds the song up, it's it's reminiscent of like Vindicated by Dashboard, where I like, man, I'm really talking about Dashboard a lot more than I actually like them, but it's such a good example here. Because like Dashboard did the Vindicated song.
Insert your own.
Yeah. But they got to where emo was like, it would build up into an anthem, right? And it could start to take you away a little bit from the just absolute whininess of the story and the moment and all that. But like Traitor does a good job of it, but never devolves back into the like, this is purely about my feelings in the moment. There's always, anytime the songs build towards statements, even across the arc of the record itself, they build towards sincere statements. Yeah. They build towards...
They reach for a truth.
Yeah. It's almost like in the song, the emotions are set up and then the conclusion is kind of like taken to a few other people and shopped around for feedback a little bit. Like, hey, yeah. Is this going to be something I want to have said in 7 years about myself? And if not, can we go ahead and like... add that in now. Can you just give me the benefit of the next 10 years? Give it here so I can look back on this in 5 years and feel super mature about it. And it's just got that feeling about it all the way through, in a way that, again, keeps building back around the production that supports it. When you get to like one step forward and three steps back, like there are birds in the background of the song, which bring you like spatially outside from Driver's License, which had you spatially inside of a car because you could hear all of the noises, you know, you could hear the beeps and all of that stuff. But then on One Step Forward and Three Steps Back, like they bring you into a different space. She's talking about like power dynamics in this, like hate that I give you power over, that kind of stuff. Like, thinking about how you give yourself power over things, again, is not an 18-year-old thing.
Right.
There's just power, and you either feel like you have it in the moment or you don't. But then even things like, I made a note around a minute and 12 seconds into that song where she says, understand. And she's talked through this whole thing and comes down to trying to communicate that she understands something. And there's a single blast of reverb on that word. Like, as if it has a finality and a space to it and a conclusion. You want me, hate me, boy, I don't understand. No, I don't understand. And then, like, 30 seconds later, they're picking up into this kind of bridge, and her vocal performance picks up a sense of agitation again. Like, that whole momentum of one step forward and three steps back, of feeling like, I'm more mature than I feel like I am age-wise, but also I don't want to miss the things I should be experiencing age-wise at this moment just because I'm thinking about being older. Like, that constant push and pull.
Where's my fucking teenage dream?
Exactly. Yeah. And like, even in that, is she talking about the Katy Perry album? You know, just being able to turn those little moments over and over again. Like, this is a really creative thing for adults to be able to play with, who appreciate like musicality and especially very good word painting type production stuff that's designed to support an overall like theme in a record. And the thing that keeps it from feeling, again, just like to where it becomes a cringy anthem thing, is because none of these songs devolve into like Pink songs.
Yeah.
Just because you can say,
we're like, I'm going to try genre X. Because that's the thing. Yeah. If she does something like that, it's like the electric guitar crunch at the end of a thing. Like you talked about earlier in the conversation, sort of the mashing part and part and part, which on paper sounds like it wouldn't work.
Right.
But nothing ever overstays its welcome, which is another very punky thing where like everything's just a little bit of a wink. It's very hard to do. I think one of the things that really stood out to me in terms of vocal performance, but I think it applies to the music as well, as the control and the nuance. Like there's not too much of anything, which is another pop problem.
Yep.
Pop is tends to be a very maximalist thing.
Yep.
Here I go feeling like Patrick Bateman a little bit. Let me cool my temp some. But she keeps everything from going to the full up and stay there place or down and stay there place. And when I think about something like a Dashboard, I hate that band. Because it's like, I'm all the way up here, or I'm all the way down.
Yeah, that's why you hate it. Yeah.
There's no nuance at all. Like, just, hey, buddy, take a breath, right?
Yes.
Like you said about the processing. She does that not only in multiple sort of swings throughout the album, but like within the song. It feels very real emotionally because she has sort of honed and crystallized, like very specific. It's this color Pantone teal feeling. And then it goes just a little further into this little different green. And it doesn't go all the way electric lime green into then all the way down to deep void black. She just like there's a dynamic range that is masterfully controlled. So when you're listening to the music aspect of this and you're hearing the space between the pieces in each song that allows you to really feel everything crystal clear, which again felt like Jolene to me. Like there's not one iota more thing in a song from a production perspective than there needs to be at any moment ever.
Yep.
Everything cuts.
Yep.
But then her vocal performance, like she already has sort of a natural control slipping in and out of sort of a serpentine sing-songy thing into a little bit of a talk thingy.
She's clearly an actor. Like she's clearly very good at that. Yeah.
Like she can go to hugely different emotional places inside of a stanza and not in a way that's jarring ever.
Right. Not in a like Celine Dion way.
Right. We're up here now. Yeah. It's like it.
Or I'm whispering.
Right. You got to listen kind of hard for it. It's a thing that like kind of hooks you in on a subconscious level. And then when you go to actively listen to the way she's performing and delivering the lyrics, everything is calibrated for maximum impact relative to the kind of feeling that she's trying to convey with the words. So those two things stay in total alignment the whole time, which is like, that's kind of more of a theater thing to your point, right? It's very hard to do without it being theatrical, but I'd argue she does it pretty much pitch perfectly the whole record.
Absolutely. I think the quickest funny example of that to me was before I was convinced that I could just like this record, and while I was trying to convince myself that I had misunderstood something and I definitely wouldn't, when I got to Good For You and it sort of drops into this like, oh no, she's about to do a rap. Oh no, oh no. And I gotta say, like, again, as a person who spent a lot of time in my life really intentionally listening to music and getting pretty good at reading patterns, understanding where things are going. I got about two beats into that measure and I went, well, this is where we're going to drop off. This is where we're going to lose it. And even that is such a killer example because when you talk about nothing overstays its welcome, this thing didn't even get like eight entire measures. Like she does a thing stylistically and is at the same time immediately morphing it into the next part of it, which is not going to feel like that at all. Good for you, I guess you're getting everything you want. You bought a new car and your career's really taking off. It's like we never even happened, baby. What the fuck is up with that? And good for you, it's like you never even met me. Remember when you swore to God I was the only person who ever got you? Well, screw that and screw you. You will never have to hurt the way you know that I do. Well, good for you. And like the ability to transition vocal styles and then separately from that transition musical styles at different times is the thing that makes these feel like they're flowing in and out so often and that it's constantly changing. But again, I think we're just drawing out the two really good things are working together here. And that's like extremely good and intricate production and very good vocal performance with a lot of intentionality around it to the point to where, you know, a song that I thought was going to be a very bad rap situation turns out to be described later as Lord covering a Dookie B-side. Like, okay, we got there from where we were at the beginning of this song. Like, it's just a real journey. And I think it's worth encouraging people, even if I would hardly blame anybody that was still skeptical, even after listening to us for this long, about why you don't have to be skeptical about this record. But even if you just do one good active listen through and hate the songs, then fine. But like, listen for the details. Like, we're not kidding. Like, people really cared about these songs.
Yeah.
And you can really feel it in the way that all the little moments of reverb, little strings, a little like the birds or the nature or the sounds or the slightly different tone that comes in or the beat that drops in. Like, lots of different pieces of intricate care about getting these songs communicated as best they could, they pay off. They pay off in a way that's really interesting to listen to, even if you don't end up like backdooring yourself into actually thinking it's really catchy like I did.
There's a moment in the documentary where she had a moment of clarity after Driver's License blew up. She's like, oh, the songs I make from here are going to be received by a lot more people than I originally ever thought my art would be. Like, this was for me until this moment. And that awareness comes through in stunning clarity with the last song on the record, Hope You're Okay, which is like, I'm going to try to get through talking about this song without losing my shit.
You mean the one that on paper is like the pretty, it gets better cringy, ballad, silly song? Yeah. And ends up actually being pretty great.
So the for the performance in the documentary, I mean, I think it's worth like pause the episode, go read all the lyrics. It is a like somebody loves you song, which is that's a very teenage thing. It's just like, you're not alone. But she pulls up on the beach in what looks like Malibu, and her band is there and they're performing, and there's a string section, and one by one, they all go jump in the ocean at the end. Just like, I'm relieved to have shared this. Like, it has gotten better for me. Like, we have therapized about all the bullshit of the adult world for a minute. And like, we have this joyous little group of people who love and support each other. And they go like, not to be weird, but they go like baptize themselves a little bit. And just the joy and the surrender of being present in a moment with other people. I don't know of a song from when we were 18 that did that with that level of grace and beauty and maturity. So the way that Me Without You fucks with you, that song, every time I think about that song, I'm like, I'm glad that shit exists.
Yeah, it's a really beautiful and thoughtful note about how to be empathetic of people's respective situations, but also be able to express a pride in the person who's in that situation for what they have been able to do. And like, I know a lot of people who I personally am proud of them that they were created with the courage to unlearn all of the hatred. Like, that's, I viscerally hate myself for loving this song so much. like I really hate it. But it's done with just enough of, again, that same thing we've been talking about. The perspective of getting older and being able to look back and see, man, look at what you were able to do in whatever situation you were in. But it's still got just enough of that raw moment and feeling where I can remember when I was around that age and I started to slowly understand, look at how hard some things are for people. Like, oh my God, my parents were great. Oh, like I was loved. Oh man, like how difficult must it be to launch out of a home where you weren't?
Yeah.
You know, I mean, everything old is new and terrible. Again, it's another time to have on our minds like what it means to grow up inside of a loving and caring home, no matter who you are, and to be able to be vulnerable and safe as a child around parents who can love and respect you. But like, man, everyone has a different level of that experience, and this song speaks to it in a way that can actually connect with you if you let it. And it is, again, an ending on paper that sounds really hokey and sort of seems like Disney was like, hey, so listen, you've been saying fuck, okay, on this record. I'm going to need you to give us something here at the end that we can like send out.
Dude, the credits.
Yeah. Please give us a soundtrack to our like paperless post invite to a dinner party. Okay. Like so that we can send out to our friends that you made this record and it's sweet and all that stuff. And yet it still has just enough to where it never quite turns into we are the world.
Right.
And that to me is what makes it impactful, because it never turns the corner into a, no, we all got this. No, some of us do not got this very much at all. And some people are in an extremely tough situation where success looks like figuring out how to survive. And I think the generations that are coming after us are a lot more aware than we were at the same time that people are having those types of struggles today. Like as children and as teenagers trying to figure out how to bust out of their homes and like be full-fledged adults, everybody's got their own difficulty in that situation and can use some encouragement in figuring out how to get out of it and in being kind to the person you were when you were trying to figure out how to launch out on your own.
Well, I hope you know how proud I am you were created with the courage to unlearn all their hatred.
God, I hope that you're happier today. 'Cause I love you. And I hope that you're okay.
So what's your parting thought? What idea or sensation do you want to leave people with?
Well, I want to leave you with the lasting dread that I have of Spotify trying to recommend things for me based on how much I've been listening to Sour for the last 3 months. I am extremely concerned. I need to understand the mechanics of the private session setting and what this is going to do to my daily mixes. To me, this in seriousness, outside of us being so post-internet where I have to worry about what an algorithm now thinks about me listening to Olivia Rodrigo so much, in sincerity...
Please don't judge me, non-sentient robot. That's big Libra energy. Did I say the wrong thing to the algorithm? Is it mad at me?
Oh,
I'm so, can I send the algorithm a paperless post to let it know that I'm sorry?
Whether it is the algorithm or the all-seeing cultural eye that we're constantly concerned with when it comes to whether I should be a person who listens to pop music like this, it's the same phenomenon.
Did not know that we would get to Jeremy Bentham's Panopticon in the Olivia Rodrigo episode, but here fucking are.
Yeah, turns out if you grow up getting told God is watching you all the time, you feel watched all the time.
Reality is a prison. Listen to Olivia Rodrigo's Sour Beat.
It's more like a hall of mirrors, but I don't know which way to step out of it. This was another moment of whether or not you got convinced on this record, fine. If you don't connect with this, fine, dude. No problem. But like, this is a really good reminder of the same
thing. But you just listened to us talk about it for an hour.
That's right. You could have listened to this twice already.
That reminds me of the part in Deja Vu I totally didn't even mention. She has the background vocalist that go, ha, 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 talking about the new girlfriend laughing at the jokes. Like, that's grown-up shit, bro. That's next level. That's an FX comedy writer's room level.
Wow, this record kind of could be an FX series, and I had never really thought about it like that.
Hi, I'm Olivia.
Oh, yeah. We need to not get her and Lil Dicky together. Now that I think about it, they should not meet. That's going to spawn something different. But, wow, here's something I didn't expect to say. A lot like Lil Dicky, all of a sudden you can get super surprised by one particular piece of music that has so much intricacy and detail and care. Like with that song that blew up. I want to call it Pangea, but what was the actual name of that song?
This bitch don't know about Pangea.
What was the actual name?
Pillow Talking.
Pillow Talk. Okay, that's right. Like, just in the same, you don't have to love this genre of music. You don't have to love Disney Channel original movies, but this is a really good reminder that, like, let your ear be surprised, especially if you're a person like us who finds yourself alive on this planet and for whatever reason, music like lights up your synapses in the right way. This is a really good record for lighting up things in your brain because it's really intriguing and interesting even on multiple listens, but it is critically a reminder that records can do this and that the only way that you can get to finding out that a record can do this is by, in a grander sense, letting other people have the aux cable sometimes. Because that's how this happened for me. I'm really glad that it did. I kind of feel like I passed the contagion along to you a little bit. And now we're just going to live the rest of our lives occasionally talking to people about how we did this super serious music podcast. And oh yeah, we covered Olivia Rodrigo, didn't we? Would you like to explain yourself? Yeah, I guess I will. Like, here's why.
Between Fela Kuti and Meshuggah.
Exactly. Yeah. And I have no regrets. I'm glad that we did it. We could have talked about this for another hour.
I'm so glad this record came into my life, dude.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Let yourself be huge and surprised by records and music. And like, this is one really good way to do it.
Go to tunedig.com for your chance to win a free vinyl copy of the album we just covered. And follow us on Instagram and Twitter for even more info about the album, including playlists, links to interesting articles and videos, and even some stories that didn't make the episode. Most importantly, though, please support your favorite local record store or concert venue or buy merch from a band you love. Thanks for listening.
His parents cared more about the Bible than being good to their own child. He wore long sleeves because of his dad.